big fans around here of making a mix, right? It's got compost, alfalfa meal, a little bit of pasteurized poultry manure. And we just saw, incredibly, because I was doing a test for people with biochar where I used none of our mix. All I used was biochar, compost, or straight compost, or nothing control, right? All of those plants are doing different things because of the various amendments they got or didn't get, but none of them have the vigor of the tomatoes that we grow with that mix. So that kind of starter mix is something I highly recommend, but I back way off of the nitrogen right about now. Because you don't want them to take up excess nitrogen. By this time of year, what we start doing is we use hardly any of the pasteurized poultry manure, a little bit, just because it's a great microbial food, and our only source of nitrogen is alfalfa, which is kind of like turning a cover crop under. It's kind of slow release, not a lot. You know, mostly minerals, good food for microbes. Your goal always, as growers, is not to put soluble nitrogen, soluble nutrients in the soil so plants can take them up. They sure can. What you'd rather do is put enough food in the soil that the incredible microbial life that you've created by growing organically or sustainably eats those nutrients. And what the plants eat are those microbes food. Are that decaying body of that microbe that died. You want that food to be in suspended animation. That way also it never leaches out. Those microbes might get washed down sometimes by a heavy rain or something, but they just move back up. They work towards the oxygen. So ideally, your goal as growers is to try to maximize your fertility by maximizing the life of your soil. So one of the best things you can do is make or get really good compost or worm castings and mix that into your soil. You can use way less fertilizer if you have some life. And even some cutting-edge conventional growers are learning that. There are cutting-edge conventional growers who now buy excellent compost, mix it with their fertilizer, using way less fertilizer. If they use too much, it's going to kill the life. But they're saving loads of money on fertilizer because they're using a little bit of life. So that's the method you're going to use to kill it. If we have time, you might have to try to plant a little area, and I'll show you how we make a mix and how we work it in. Okay. So that's the reason why you want to be careful harvesting at the end of the sunny day. And I kind of got off there, but I wanted to get to that one quickly. I didn't want to forget that piece. That's a real important piece. Years ago, my partner was working at Earth Fair, which was at Dinner for the Earth, and somebody had a crystal, and they were dousing. My partner said, oh, douse this lettuce I just brought in from Pat's greenhouse. And she doused it, and it came up not good. And she came up and told me, I said, well, that shows you how useful that dousing is, you know, because we knew it was the best darn lettuce in the world. We'd done everything organic. It was spectacular. It tasted good. At that point, I didn't know about harvesting again on a sunny day. Excellent chance that it was loaded with too much nitrogen. I'm not saying the dowsing really, I don't know, but I have to now go back and say, well, maybe, you know, maybe it knew something that I didn't know. I don't know. I don't really try and judge that stuff. I let everybody figure that stuff out for themselves. Okay, so back to the families. We covered most of the families. There's two left that are major. Okay, there's so many families. Spinach family. Spinach, chard, what else is in that family? Lamb's quarters, a very unusual herb, epazote. There's some perennial ones, like Good King Henry. This is a perennial bean that's similar to spinach, or to chard. There's not commonly one known as auric, O-R-A-C-H. That one's fun. If you like color, you might want to get Frank Morton's. Frank Morton's my favorite plant breeder. He's what he does is like breed diversity back into things. You know, our diversity is disappearing. Frank Morton is reversing that. Frank Morton actually will sell to the seed industry things like wild kale mix, wild chicory mix. And then what happens is people get those mixes and find varieties they like in there and select them out and create new varieties. Means he's reversing our loss of diversity. He's created this amazing, almost fluorescent colors, like pinks and golds and maroons from this orc. So you can actually buy this green. I mean, really, I don't tend to grow it up big. I don't think it makes enough production. It's very wonderful. You you get excited about salad mix, just sow this thick, cut them when they're about that tall. You just get these incredibly colorful greens. It's fun. Is it more nutritious than lamb quarters? No, probably not. It might be a little less. The more we breed in pretty colors, the more we tend to breed out nutrition. But it's a lot of fun. You gotta feed yourself every way, right? You gotta have that food be exciting too. And so that's what you can get from that. So, and spinach, by the way, spinach, I'm gonna go over shortly a list of ones that are like this. Spinach is one of the hardiest of all foods. You can have spinach out and it can take loads of frost without damage, and then it can finally be damaged. But if you just give it a light mulch, not too heavy mulch so it doesn't rot, right? You don't want to cover it up, just kind of a little bit of protection. It'll just sit there and look unhappy all winter, and come on, as soon as February starts to get warm and the days get longer, and by sometime in March, huge, watch it grow with spinach, tons of spinach. And then, just as you're getting used to it, go bold. And so you gotta have your spring spinach coming in. It'll give you a big flush because it's trying to build up a bunch of energy, make a lot of seed. But it will give you spinach earlier than any spring spinach, and you don't even need to protect it. So it works very well that way. And so that's the chenopodium family. Chard is one of those stars for winter production. You can just grow huge amounts of chard in here. Very, very good. Beets. Couldn't grab one thing. Beets. Beets are in this kind of course. And you grow the greens and the roots. And I'd say, if you want winter beets, get them in sometime very soon. Because they're going to give you much more size. Either that, or plant them quite late and let them go like after solstice, and then let them grow into the spring. They will slow down. Really, it has to do with how much light and probably something to do with how much warmth too, because I couldn't get beets. If I put them in sometime after the middle of October, I couldn't get beets in Ceylon. But here, they put them in that late and got beets. I'd say, if you want to be safe, plant them next week. Plant them this, sometime early this week coming up. And then you'll be pretty darn certain that that's a big crop. Personally, we like the farm, the personnel on this farm, personally, we prefer to grow our beets in cell packs and plant them out. We have better take because we're really bothered by Cercospora, the disease that makes those red spots on the leaves, and they can really be torn up out the ground. This year, not as much. We grow them in a greenhouse or someplace away from that disease and the high humidity on the ground, then we get nice big starts and put them out, they'd be fine. But if you don't have that disease, if you don't see red spots on your beet or chard leaf, then you probably don't have that disease. You also will see it on dock. People know curly dock and common dock, not burdock, but those other two weeds. I'll show you in the garden. You see those red spots on those too. If you have a lot of that, then you might want to grow them in cell packs. But beets, winter grown beets, the sweetness, the richness, quite spectacular. The next family is the allium family. That's onions, chives, bunching onions, scallions, shallots, all of those are quite hardy, just need some protection. Probably the mother, the matriarch of the family, of course, is garlic. It doesn't need any protection. Leeks are spectacular, and there's a variety of leeks. You can grow the summer leeks, and they're actually a lot of fun. You can actually harvest one or two, see what they look like, and then figure out how to cook them up, try to taste them, and the rest of the food that they would go with it. They have a really long white shank, and you get a whole lot of white shank from them. You can bury them real deep and get even more. That is not that hard. Have those, they'll be fine probably sometime towards Thanksgiving, then they'll start taking damage. The winter grown ones are much stubbier and squatter, and they're more of a bulb. And then names for ones like that are things like American flag, blue soleil. There's a bunch of them that are winter grown leaves. So those are way better for deep cold. So what you might want to do is, you could actually literally see the summer leaves right now and grow them with protection in the greenhouse. And they'll give you baby leeks before they want to bolt next. They're going to try and bolt on you once again. That's actually not once again. I've been telling you that things will bolt at a certain time, and I'll explain to you why. It's important to know why. Plants, lots of plants, are biennials, and even a lot of annuals, have to experience winter before they make seed. And the fancy word for that is they have to vernalize. It's a Latin word for winter. And once they've experienced winter, and then the days start to get longer, go home. One of the classic ones that you see all the time that does this is the Chinese cabbages and the Chinese salad. Those guys, once they freeze around solstice, very short time after that, and they bolt. They can freeze a bunch, and they won't bolt until after solstice. But as soon as the days start getting longer, up they go. If they don't freeze though, and I learned this one by experience. I had a friend who took a winter gardening class with me, and like often happens, he figured he'd do better. So he made a big greenhouse, and then he made a plastic tunnel inside it. And then on the really cold nights, he put a row cover over the plants underneath. On the bitter cold nights, he covered the tunnel above. I got there after Christmas because he told me he had this greenhouse full of Chinese cabbage and bok choy and all these things like mizuna and katsoi that he wanted to sell. And I said, we got to sell these immediately because they're all going to bolt. So I got out there to see what he had, to help figure out how to sell it, because he'd become a friend by then. I don't run out there every place, but I don't know how. But yeah, he was actually my chicken lady. He was teaching me chicken stuff. So I got out there and I looked. Well, these guys, I don't see one bolt. Why aren't they starting to bolt? It was like, you know, the end of Christmas week. Usually by then they're starting to bolt. And then I noticed that there was a solanaceous tomato family weed in there that would help me. I said, it's never frozen in here, has it? He said, nope. I mean, you can literally put enough layers on it that with no heat, it doesn't freeze. And so since it hadn't frozen, they weren't going to hold. He didn't have to hurry. He had the rest of the winter to sell those weeds because stuff never froze, so it wasn't going to hold. They have to experience winter. So that's something you want to know. And a lot of things, just get used to the cycle. It's like, I grow Chinese cabbages, bok choy and stuff up until Christmas. I use them up. I start some more in January. There's this little window where I don't have it. It works. And then actually, for a lot of them, if they have less than four leaves, they haven't experienced winter yet. So it doesn't matter. So you can literally seed them, you know, sometime between solstice and New Year's, and they probably wouldn't be big enough to even notice it. And then they could have a little head start. So that would give you more of a window. I mean, a smaller window of no green. And of course, they'll keep in the fridge. You know, you hardly have a time you can't grow. Some things bolt, it's no problem. Arugula, when it bolts, if you ever taste an arugula flower, it's actually incredibly delicious. Got all the taste of arugula plus that nectar kind of taste. Really amazing. Anyway, back to the alliums. So you can grow winter leeks and you can grow summer leeks. You can grow both in our situation because you have that protection. You might decide your winter leeks are going to get nothing but row cover. Mulch. And they're the ones that give you the volume, and you have those going to bottom plant them out, it's too late. But next year you put some winter leeks in sometime in June. You know, just have them started, you know, usually it's about 6 weeks till they're big enough, or 8 weeks. Plant them out in June. By now they'll be looking gorgeous. Just put plants in the bank. You don't do anything with them. You're eating your summer leeks that you protect, you know, and they don't freeze. And then sometime in dead winter, go down in the root cellar of your basement, get your homegrown potatoes. Get some of those leeks and make potato leek soup. Dig those leeks out of the ground. You can dig those leeks out of the ground frozen. You know, not so frozen that they won't come out, but they can be kind of frozen and they'll still work great. Another one that you can either protect or not protect, that's one of my favorites, and we'll walk there and look at it. It's part of our meal tonight. Evergreen hardy bunching onion. Evergreen hardy bunching onion is just one of my favorite plants. And why I love it so much is make sure that I never harvest every one from a bunch. I can forget about it. I come back a little later, there's more onions. They just keep growing and growing. And indeed, I recommend a strategy. We have done, and my co-workers forgot that that was why we did it the way we did it, and they worked with that up. Just slowed them down, figured we'd start some new ones. But the intention I had actually was I took those onions as plants, and then I got mycorrhizal inoculum. Mycorrhizal inoculant is fungi, right, that have a symbiotic relationship with plants. And we would not have the incredible fertility we have in our garden. We wouldn't have a lot of the organic matter we have in our garden trees wouldn't grow, all kinds of things did not work without mycorrhizae. Literally, for loads of plants like onions, which have pretty big roots, not a lot of fine roots, right? They count on the mycorrhizae to be their fine roots. Likewise, squash. We all know that squash is a heavy feeder, right? First time I was learning about mycorrhizae, I was on the phone with the guy who sold it, and he's just one of these passionate guys, and he was just saying, you know, squash, they say it's a heavy feeder. If you get the mycorrhizae on it, it's not a heavy feeder. Because it naturally, in nature, has these fine root hairs, and they get the nutrients that we have to give lots of material to if we don't have the mycorrhizae. And if you grow conventionally, the high salts of the fertilizer, kill the mycorrhizae. If you use herbicides, kill the mycorrhizae. If you grow organic, try not to work your soil too much. Eventually, you won't need to use the inoculant. It'll show up, it's everywhere. Trees have it. But what you can do is buy the inoculant once, and buy it a second time because we didn't remember to keep this onion bed going. Take some of your onions, dip their roots in the inoculant, put them in a bed. Remember that you're never going to pull every one of those onions. So you're always going to have bunches of onions there. Then take an onion, plant it next to your squash plant. You can eat that onion later on. But let those roots grow. They're going to intermingle with the squash roots. You know, roots are not particularly solitary. They really mix up with each other and grow together, right? And those fungi are going to grow right in you. Remind me to tell you about the living web at dinner time. It's not really appropriate to tell you this now, though I'm dying to tell you. But remind me to tell you at dinner time, the living web story. It's really amazing, very amazing. So you want those mycorrhizae, and you can make yourself a permanent bed evergreen hardy bunchy onion that is your repository of onion. So you don't buy an onion anymore, you just take an infected root plant in the plant. Make sure you dig it. Don't rip that onion out, because it'll grow if you do that, right? Just a few little teeny roots, it'll grow, but it's not gonna have much inoculant. Dig it out carefully, right? With that soil. Transplant the whole thing next to your squash. And then you have your squash having the inoculant. And by the way, there's also a fair chance that some of the light that's in on that onion will help you protect the squash from fungal diseases in the soil. Excuse me, I need to take a quick drink of water and walk up over here.
You're amazing. You're a testament to the food you eat.
I have had complaints. I've had complaints about, I had to write 12 pages, I still couldn't get it all down. By the way, if I'm talking too fast, tell me to slow down. I tend to.
It's great energy.
I'm from the Northeast.
It's phenomenal. People, absolutely phenomenal.
People walk and talk and drink lots of coffee. Anyway, let's see, what else can I tell you about the Allium family? Chives. Chives will go well into December and start up again in February. You can have them under cover and they'll go a little later, quite well outside. And not everything you talk about today. I really push the combination of protecting things I'm going to show you, and that's a way to really assure and maximize production. But there are plants, and I've got some of them listed here, I think. Some of them listed that are actually quite hardy, and you can grow for much of the winter with no protection at all, and some absolutely no protection ever. Star, as far as I know, so maybe somebody disagrees, but the star is Mosh. Mosh, no protection. I've never seen it be damaged no matter how cold it is. It is the most cold hardy thing, and I call it one of the perennially self-seeding annuals. It is not a perennial, but if you let it go to seed, it always comes back. I've recommended to people that, you know, if you have a non-toxic, not poison, you know, if you poison your flower bed, don't do this, but if you've got an organic flower bed, don't use it in the winter. If you plant Mosh in there in the spring and let it go to seed, just as your flowers are finishing, the bottom of that bed underneath your flowers will be covered with this nice green carpet of Mosh. So that's another way to get them to maximize. If you don't have a lot of space, you figure out these ways to maximize your production. So let's see, besides Mosh, some of my hardiest, Tango lettuce. Tango lettuce. Actually, Barbara Webster, who used to live in Yancey County, she actually had Tango lettuce on automatic. It self-seeded, and it was in a kind of protected place against rocks. And she just cut lettuce all winter, and she never had to grow it. I mean, she grew it, but she didn't do anything. It just grew itself. With no protection, it will frost kill. Eventually, it'll get cold enough to frost kill. But it won't, kill's the wrong word. It'll kill, it'll die back. There'll be this little green rosette. One year at Mountain Air, when I grew vegetables for their restaurant, we had a nice bed of mixed salads. We could come again until the frost found them too messy. And they just weren't working with them anymore. And so then they all died back because of the cold, because of the protection on them, right? Except for I noticed a few little green rosettes. Next spring, everywhere there'd been a tango lettuce, big fat rosette of lettuce, came right back. Groom de Bear, which is also on this list, and Hansen's Winter are other lettuces that will never really winter kill. They'll winter die back, but they'll come back as soon as the weather starts to warm up, they'll start to grow again. So you can actually get them to keep producing. You use a little bit of fabric, you probably keep them growing nothing much else. You use fabric and plastic, and you just can't stop them. For several years, Spectrum Seed Cadillac quoted me, then they stopped. And I know why, because I only had these results one time, too. It was February, I think, and I started cutting a newly ready bed for my market, because I sold at winter markets. And this was a bed that I planted sometime in, right before Thanksgiving. So it had had tons of time, just mid-February, to grow, and I never cut it. And so it got really strong and deep. And if you notice, one of the reasons tango is so productive, and you think it's a wonderful come again lettuce, is because it's got an inordinately strong root system. And that tends towards hardiness, because it can now get more minerals and don't frost to you. Well, I had not cut this root, so I had not cut it back, so the root system had really developed. I was able to cut that same salad every week for market. Now, I didn't get the same big heads, of course they couldn't go back that far, but I was getting like that much once a week. And they quoted me in February like that, and then finally pulled it because, of course, I didn't even get that. I haven't gotten that result for a long time. But it does happen. It's that productive. Usually, probably more like 10 days or 14 days before you can cut again. But you can come again for that. And it is incredibly productive. And I think it's got a, my partner and I think it's got a very nice, distinctive taste for lettuce. Also, it gives you a lot of ruffle. It's real ruffly. So it looks real pretty on salads. Okay, arugula. Arugula, tatsoi, oftentimes red mustard, kale, collards, cilantro, mosh, evergreen hardy lettuce. The one that really doesn't fully deserve to be there, unless it's up against the rock, or a little protector, that's all it needs, is miner's lettuce, also known as Bretonian. That one with no protection will not make it through the tons of cold. But these other ones, if you've been growing for a while, you've probably seen this gorgeous Rosetta tatsoi. It takes everything you throw at it, right? It just, I mean, finally, eventually, it gets overwhelmed. But it takes some time in January or something, right? I mean, it just like, it just goes and goes. You know, cilantro too, right? They're just like, then it just gets sweet. You know, it goes from being just cilantro to sweet cilantro, which is amazing. So these are the guys that you need no protection from. Or very little protection. Like I say, up against the rock, or the, you know, on a south-facing hill that's maybe got a raised bed above it, that's where the miner's lettuce will probably do without protection. With nothing but rug cover, it cranks all winter. Both mosh and miner's lettuce do not get bitter or lose quality as they go to seed. So you can literally cut them with the flowers and stuff, they're still excellent. Both of them are amazing self-seeders too. They'll just really come on and come on. Okay, we still haven't got to all the families. There's one last family left. That is the composite family. Lettuces and radicchio chicories. All of them. I mean, I've already mentioned some of them and I talked about the lettuce and radicchio. But that entire family, anything in that family, that party, easy to grow straight to the winter. And then there's some, you know, unusual ones, like there's one called Venusia that is actually a cultivar of plantain. Does everybody know plantain would be?
Yeah.
Anybody not know it? Everybody know that you can use that to relieve beach stings? Okay, I always go off topic here because some information just has to be shared, right? You get stung by a bee, you go to the first plantain plant you can find, which you can almost always find even in the city. Chew it up, I don't mind chewing up in the city. If you're hurting enough, you might. Chew it up, stick it on that bee sting, start chewing on the leaf. Keep doing that until it doesn't hurt. Keep your plate. As soon as you have another piece chewed up, put the next piece on. I ever get bit by a snake, for the hospital, but I'm doing that on the way. I heard about it from somebody who used it to pull glass out of the doctor's room. It draws that much. Clay, tobacco, wouldn't chew tobacco on, but whatever. There are several things that'll do that, but plantain's the one that's in the garden you can use anytime. And it's edible. But not that exciting to eat. You get the very smallest leaves, lots of coal, it's good to eat and quick, it's an awful lot of work. You can get this one called minutia. It has an incredibly crispy leaf that you can cut maybe twice. It kind of loses quality, but it takes loads of coal. And it's not in any of those families, and I'm sure if I try, likewise, the miner's lettuce is not in those families. There are some other odd ones that may come to you, but the big ones are chenopodiums, the onions, the brassicas, the APACA. Those are all that we mentioned, right? And the composites. Those are the families that they're all basically these quarter party, and you can use the materials we're going to talk about next, and then we'll go down and start doing some demos showing you some things you can do with them. Okay? They'll just all work that way. Okay, so what's the way? The way, right, is, I told you already, but I'm going to say it, right? First thing to do when you start your right now, if you plant this week, you are not planting a fall garden. Right? It's a common mistake people have. They go, sometime in August, they'll say to me, I'm going to plant a fall garden. There's a few things you can plant for fall now, but really, your fall garden should be planted in June, right? Or July. Because when do you plant a summer garden? Not in the summer, right? Or not, you know. Some things you plant towards the end of the spring, but mostly you're planting stuff earlier for your summer garden. Likewise for your fall garden, right? You want things like parsnips, carrots, Brussels sprouts, cabbages, broccoli and stuff. They got to go in sometime between late June and July. Yeah. Then there are things in August that you can plant, things like watermelon radish, turnips, spinach, things like that, right? But for those kale towers and stuff, they're going to be way more productive if you get them in sometime in July. You can do them in August, but by September, you're going to be eating those. Nah, I mean, it still is actually fall. I guess technically it's a fall garden, but it sure feels like winter, right? You're wearing a winter coat, you've got snow tires on your car before you're eating that stuff, right? So it's going to grow. It needs at least, 6 to 8 to 10 weeks to get big enough to eat, right? So you're going to plant those things as soon as you can now, harvest them, still fall, but basically if you're planting now, you're looking to eat sometime in November. Yeah. Some things, and some things later, like this time. It depends also on how big you're going to pick them. You can grow kale and be picking it. If you plant it now, you're picking it towards the end of October, but if you pick it too hard, you're going to lose some of your total yield. And that by the way, is an okay strategy. You don't have kale starts going right now, seed yourself a row. And don't worry if you seed it kind of thick, right? Then your spacing is food, right? So you want it every 15 inches, let's say, or whatever you want. Everything in between, you eat at any stage you want. You can tiny baby kales and salads, right? You can wait till they're about that big. Thin first, right next to where you plant this, right? So it has space. And then towards the middle, where it's going to least impact the plants you're leaving, because the ones are there. So that's a strategy whereby you can actually sow and eat, but not eat just a few plants, and then you get to that big thing. So then you get to have your fall garden, your winter garden, one soil food. And that means you're saving space. So that's a trick to do every time. You can always do that. You can also plant, let's say, a row, and sometimes it doesn't work. I'll show you where it's not working too well, because time, I didn't plant the daikon soon enough. We have just two rows of pak choy out there in the garden, and I planted daikon down the middle of it. The pak choy was well established, and it's going to be too big, it's going to shade that daikon. Had I sown the daikon the minute I planted the pak choy, the daikon would be up and able to hold its own. The pak choy would have felt a little push, it would have just grown out more towards the edge. Now it's kind of taken up that space, because it can, the daikon is. So those are ways to jam that stuff in. Okay, so, to grow, you're going to plant either your fall or winter garden, I guess I won't argue about whatever it is, but it's definitely not a fall garden that you need right now. Fall, you can't eat it if you haven't planted, right? So you want to start that stuff earlier so you're eating now in the fall. It's not even fall, right? But anyways, to me, the seasons are more by, it sure feels like fall, doesn't it? And so that's how I think about it. Anyway, you're planting fall crops, and you know you're going to have to protect it from frost, right? Okay. Standard thing to do is to think, I got to get some row cover. What a lot of us do is hear on the radio as we're driving to work that it's going to frost tonight, saying, and row cover, they go home tonight. I hope somebody has it, right? You get out there, you had to get dinner started, let's say. Why is it going to frost? Because a big front's coming in. You're trying to put the row cover on. It's blowing like crazy. It's the I Love Lucy show in your garden. You know, I mean, it's just going to look ridiculous. The cover's going to be blowing all over the place. What a mess. If you do what I do sometimes, sometimes I'm the person I just described, but if you do what I recommend, when you say it's going to frost when you go cover, you go get that row cover, and you buy some staples. Everybody know what the staples are? I got my favorite place to get it on. There's several, you can make number of other places. I recommend, by the way, if you find some people to share it with and buy a box full of staples, you can have to leave the markup if you're buying just 40 staples or something. It's scary, isn't it? It is scary. They normally cost about 3 cents each. You can spend 40 cents to 50 cents each from some sort of some suppliers, you know. So buy $30, buy you 1,000. I mean, you know, you just buy the box and then when your friends need them, sell them at half off the cost of what they pay in catalogs. It could be a small business.